And I'm going to talk about the power that's in the gospel.
Yes.
Because while I'm dealing with prophecy and events that are taking place, you need to understand that God has called you to be a witness and to share your faith with others. And I'm going to talk about that power that comes in the everlasting gospel of Revelation 14. The power of God. We're going to talk about the issues that we do not wrestle with flesh and blood. And I'm going to share some experiences dealing with demonic issues. Now, we don't always like to talk about that. And some ministers will not touch on it because they are not geared in their messages of prosperity to deal with demonic issues. But ladies and gentlemen, the devil and his angels are very real.
Oh, yes.
And they're more real than you and I can even imagine. They speak to you like natural men and women, and yet his desire is your destruction. He'll do anything and everything he can to bring it about through others or through bringing you into indulgences or tempting sensual situations that are calculated to destroy you. Now, tonight, I would like you to turn your Bibles with me. We want to claim a promise found in John 16, 13. John 16, 13. And our subject is going to be without an intercessor. We're going to start off with, and when we do go to our Bible, we're going to look at Revelation 15, 8. All right? We're going to break it down from the Bible. But John 16, 13 says, "Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come." Now, the Bible says the Holy Spirit will do what? Guide you into what? All truth. And then it says that he will what? He will not speak of himself, but whatsoever things he shall hear, that shall he
speak.
And he will what? Meaning that one of his main purposes is to show you future events before they happen, that you might be prepared for the event. With that thought in mind, let's have a word of prayer together. Father in heaven, we approach thy throne of grace in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, where the final work of judgment is now taking place. We ask thee for the presence of your Holy Spirit, that he will abide with us and that he will be in us, that he will guide us into all truth and show us things to come. Yes. Father, we ask thee that you will please help us rightly divide the word of truth. And let us all understand that mercy will not always plead, that God will not always be trifled with, that judgments will come, wrath will come, and only those whose names are found written in the book of life will be saved. Oh, Father, please, grant that our names will be in the book. Grant that we might escape the terrible wrath of the seven last plagues that are coming. More terrible than any storm, more terrible than any flood, more terrible than even in the days of Noah. More terrible than Sodom and Gomorrah. Lord, the seven last plagues. When them is filled the wrath of God without mercy. Father, please help us avoid it. And help us avoid the mark of the beast.
Yes,
we ask this now in Jesus' name and for his sake.
Yes.
Amen. Turn me back in your Bibles to Revelation chapter 15, verse 8.
Yeah.
Remember yesterday, we talked about the 144,000. We talked about how God will also blot sin out. Remember? Well, today we're going to look at that a little bit closer, but we're going to start off looking at without an intercessor. And I'm going to read a statement to you from the Spirit of Prophecy writings, but I'm going to prove it from the Bible. Okay? You hear what I say?
Yes.
Why? Because this church has two identified marks. We keep the commandments of God, and we have the testimony of Jesus Christ. The testimony of Jesus Christ is the testimony of the prophets. We have among us a prophet. And I'm not ashamed to say it, because in the New Testament church, God says he will have some apostles and some prophets, as well as teachers. The only thing you have to do with the prophet, though, is test the prophet to see if the prophet is speaking according to the word of God. In Isaiah 8:20, the Bible says to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it's because there is no life in them. Are you with me now?
Yes.
Let's see what the Bible, I want to read a statement to you though. Listen very carefully. This is from the book Early Writings, page 71. There is no forgiveness of sin after the close of probation. I'm telling you and I'm warning you ahead of time, your time to get right with God is now. Because when God closes probation, you're going to find out what that means in a moment. When he closes probation, there is no more forgiveness of sin. You can pray all you want. Do you know the Bible said a time will come when God will not hear you? You will cry and plead, but he will not hear. We'll find out why. Listen carefully. It goes on and says here, when Christ leaves the sanctuary, darkness covers the inhabitants of the earth. In that fearful time, the righteous must live in the sight of a holy God without an intercessor. The restraint which has been upon the wicked is removed, and Satan has entire control of the final impediment. Satan has entire control of the final what? Impediment. It says here, God's long-suffering has ended. The world has rejected his mercy. And it says here, despised his love and trampled upon his law. Wicked have passed the boundary of their probation. The Spirit of God, persistently resisted, has at last been withdrawn. This is from Great Controversy, page 614. You want to know the book Great Controversy? You notice in the back there, this is one of the deluxe editions of it. And this book is where I'm quoting that actually from. If you don't have this book, you should get it. Because this book is going to talk about past, present, and future events.
Yes.
Plus, it's going to give you your Bible scriptures as well. It's going to show you what is coming to the United States of America. What's really going to happen with the issue when the Pope and the Protestant world come together. If you didn't never know, if you want to know what's really about to happen, if you really want to know what the mark of the beast is, and also be able to find it from the scriptures as well, as have a commentary that will give you a clear understanding of it, this book you need to get. Without a shadow of a doubt. Now, I'm going to talk more about it later. And now, and if you got any questions on the Bible, question and answer format, you want to know about the Holy Spirit, you want to know about the judgment that we talked about earlier this week, you want to know about any of those events, you need to get a little book called Bible Readings for the Home. This is not a Bible, but it's a question and answer on the Bible. 4,000 question and answers, 300 Bible subtopics. Divided, and usually it's like they divide in 18 parts, like having an 18 volume set in your home, but it's in one volume. And if you want to really know, you can get this book and then give you a question and answer from the scriptures alone, so that you can study it on your own when you want time. It talks about the issue of the Sabbath. It talks about Sunday observance. It talks about the penalty of transgression, objects of Christ's coming, the object of Christ's coming. Why is Jesus coming? What is his object for him coming? Is he just going to, is he going to be, and will everybody see Jesus? Is the manner of his coming secret? He's going to talk about that here, the manner of Christ's coming. And all you got to do is take your Bible and go through the scriptures and look up the text, and you'll see for yourself on this subject matter. So I'm just letting you know ahead of time. We'll talk more about it later. But what I want you to see tonight is we deal with the issue without an intercessor. And when probation closes, when Christ steps out. Now probation is the allotted time given to man for the development of character, to have the image of God restored in him through the preaching of the everlasting gospel. That's what probation actually means. And that probationary period is given to you by the grace of God through the death of Jesus Christ on Calvary and his work as your high priest in the heavenly sanctuary, in the holy place, and in the most holy place. Now, we found out earlier this week that there is a sanctuary in heaven. Remember?
Yes.
Look at Hebrews 8, 1 and 2 with me for a moment. Turn with me there. Hebrews 8, 1 and 2. The Bible said, now the things we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such an high priest that is sat on the right hand of the majesties in heaven, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched and not man. The Bible said he's a minister of what, everybody? Sanctuary. Another word for sanctuary is temple. What's another word for sanctuary, everybody? Temple. And the Bible said Jesus is the minister of a heavenly temple, or a heavenly what?
Sanctuary.
The Bible said the Lord pitched it and not man. Not only that, it says here, it goes on and says something about the fact that it is a, what type of sanctuary? True tabernacle. The word true tabernacle, the actual Greek transliteration reads in that area, true tabernacle means it's there, and the expression is, whether you believe it or not, it doesn't matter because it's there.
Amen.
So rather you won't want, because you don't see it, you say it's no sanctuary in heaven. But the Bible says there is a sanctuary in heaven. Now, why should I believe the Bible? Some people say, because man wrote the Bible. But did God use any type of man to write the Bible?
No.
Did God use a drunkard to write the Bible?
No.
Did God use an atheist to write the Bible?
No.
Did God use an infidel?
No.
Anybody like that? Anybody?
No.
Huh? Did God use, let me put it this way. Did God use a well-educated people to write the Bible?
No.
No, he didn't. The Bible says in 2 Peter 1:21, well, turn with me there. I want you to see it from the Bible for a moment. This is what you just see with me as we talk about this point. But I want you to see why we can trust the Bible as we talk about these things. Look what the Bible says. For it says, for the prophecy came not, 2 Peter 1:21. It says, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the what? Holy Ghost. What type of men were these, everybody?
Holy
men. So God didn't use infidels, and God didn't use unholy people. God used holy men to write his word. So man did write the Bible, but not just any type of man. Holy men that were under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. Alright? Not some philosopher that like Socrates or Aristotle or Plato. Are you with me now? We're talking about holy men of God that were moved by the Holy Ghost. Holy men mean men that were set aside for a sacred purpose, and who was sanctified by the power of God, meaning they wrote on the inspiration, and therefore as a result, we have the word of God today. Let's go a little bit closer though. The Bible was written by 40 different authors over a period of 1,500 years. 39 books in the Old Testament, 27 in the New. 1,189 chapters in your Bible. Let's go a little bit closer though. The Bible is the Bible really inspired though? Why should I believe the Bible? So many people say, I don't need to believe the Bible. Every time you look around in the movies and all the different things you see on TV, they make Christians look like they're fanatics or weirdos.
Yeah.
Oh man, you're a Christian, you're weird. Something wrong with, ooh, no. That's because Hollywood has a war on God.
Yes.
Hollywood has a war going on against God's Ten Commandment law.
Yes.
Hollywood has a war going on to get people to renounce God. This country was built on the foundation and principles of God, his word, and his holy law, believe it or not. And now we live in such a time where people believe they are outgrown the Bible, or the Bible is an old fogey book. It's for people who are stuck up, or people who are fanatical, or extremely mentally ill. You know they are. You know that's what they're saying now. If you believe the Bible, you must be mentally ill. It's amazing, a mentally ill people built this country, and yet,
yeah.
You know, it's very interesting, don't you think? When the first pilgrims landed on Plymouth Rock, they must have been really mentally ill when they said, we have a country without a king and a religion without a pope.
Yes.
I want you to just understand, they couldn't have been mentally ill, because after that they built a nation, and in the nation, because of the persecution that went on under the old world, under the church and state unity that was under the papacy, they decided they would not have a church and state union. You know, just two days ago, we celebrated the 800th anniversary of the Magna Carta came 2 days ago. And you know, most of us didn't even know what that represented. The Magna Carta actually was the first document that gave us the right to have what you call civil liberties. Not the right to be arrested and to know why you're being arrested. The right to have a witness, the right to trial by jury. Before that, under the inquisitional laws of Rome, you had no rights. You could be arrested and picked up. Sound familiar to that? If they suspect you of a terrorist today, you could be picked up, arrested, and you can be taken away without your family even knowing you got picked up. That's if you're suspected. And then at the same time, we got laws that if we do suspect, we can also have you killed. But what happened to that? Well, why was the Magna Carta so important? The Magna Carta was a document that laid the foundation for the United States Constitution, and also the civil liberties that you and I have enjoyed all these years, which we are losing step by step because of the laws of terrorism as we fight a foreign power, and now the laws are seeming to even loom over our heads in America, and we are also now about to lose our freedoms of speech, conscience, and everything else. You know, you crack a joke, you might be sitting up in prison somewhere.
Yeah. Sure, yeah.
You gotta be careful what you say in the airports and other place else. Because all that is infringement of freedom of speech.
Yeah.
True.
But we're doing it under the name of national security. Mm-hmm. So you can see we are living in strange times. Amen. We're living in the very time of the end. Mm-hmm. Let's go to the Bible, though. The Bible talks about, so we find there's a sanctuary where? In heaven. Is there a sanctuary in heaven? Yes or no?
Yes.
All right. And who's the minister of that sanctuary? We found out. Jesus. What Bible text tells us Jesus is the minister of that sanctuary in heaven?
Hebrews.
You got Hebrews 8, 1 and 2, but they didn't tell me about Jesus. It just says we have such a high priest. But if we go to Hebrews 4, 14, we read that Jesus is that minister of that, is that high priest. Go to Hebrews 4, 14 with me. Let's see what he's doing. Hebrews 4, 14. Are you there?
Yes. Amen.
In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14, the Bible says here, are you there? The Bible says, seeing then that we have such a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the what? Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest that cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. So we have such a what? Great high priest. Where? That passed into what? Heavens. When did he pass into the heavens? After his crucifixion, after his death and resurrection, after 40 coming back down to earth, 40 days with the disciples, when he told them to tarry 10 days, and on the day of Pentecost, he began to become anointed to begin his work as high priest in the heavenly sanctuary. 18 centuries, he stood in the first apartment called the Holy Place. The holy place had the table of showbread, it had the candlestick, and it had the golden altar. And in 1844, according to the Bible prophecy of Daniel 8:14, unto 2,000 he said unto me, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. In Daniel 8:14, he moved from the holy place into the most holy place. Daniel 7:9-10 tells us about that move. I beheld to the thrones were cast down, and the ancient of days his sit, whose garments was white as snow. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousands, thousands men under him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set. The books were opened. So we find that Jesus moved into the area of judgment. And I beheld in the night vision to behold one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven, and they brought him near before him. And there was given him a kingdom, glory, and dominion. Jesus will receive the kingdom, the glory, and dominion when he has finished his work as high priest, because Jesus is a priest king.
Yes.
Yes. Are you with me now? Yes. I want to make sure you understand. So look here with me as we go a little bit closer now. So we find that in the sanctuary in heaven, Christ is the minister of that sanctuary. But what exactly is Jesus doing in heaven as your high priest? Look what the Bible said in Hebrews 8:1. It says, we have such a high priest, not of things we have spoken, this to some. We have such a high priest who is sat on the what?
Right
hand of God. Now stop for a moment. What is the right hand a symbol of in Bible? When it says he's at the right hand of God, what does that mean? He's at the right hand of God. What does the right hand symbolize in the Bible? Some people say power. But now what Bible text you got to show that the right hand is power? Because, you know, you can say a lot of things, but you still got to prove it from where? From the scriptures, is that right? Turn me to Romans 8:34. Romans chapter 8, verse 34. Let's see what the Bible says in Romans 8:34. I'll turn there with you, but I can't wait too long for you now. You got to get there and say amen.
Amen.
Are you there?
Amen.
Romans 8:34. I'm there already. The Bible says here in Romans 8:34, who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, is risen again, and is even where, everybody?
Right.
At the right hand of God, who also maketh what? Intercession for us. So wait a minute. The Bible said Jesus is at the right hand of God, but the right hand, I asked you earlier, what does the right hand mean? Now he's at the right hand making what? Intercession for us. But now wait a minute. What does the right hand itself mean? In Isaiah 41:10, the Bible tells you what the right hand is a symbol of. Let's go there for a moment, and we're going to put these two texts together. In Isaiah 41:10. When you get there, just say amen. Isaiah chapter 41,
amen.
Verse 10. Are you there?
Amen.
The Bible says, fear not, I am with thee.
Yes.
And be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. The Bible shows the right hand is a symbol of God's strength.
Yes.
And in that right hand, he ministers what? Righteousness.
Yes.
And what is righteousness?
Turn me in your Bible. Let's see what righteousness really is. He says, at the right hand of God, he will minister righteousness to us, and he will do it as a high priest and an intercessor. Are you with me now? Because you got to put your text together. You see, when you go from text to text, you're not just getting a text here and just guessing at it. You are connecting text to your subject matter.
Amen.
Our subject matter is without an intercessor. Without an intercessor means you got to have a high priest to do that. And Christ is your high priest. And when will he come out from being your high priest? We're going to get to that. But right now, I'm showing you what does it mean for Christ, your high priest, in the heavenly sanctuary to stand at the right hand of God. First of all, it's a symbol of what, everybody? Strength. All right, let's go a bit closer and we'll see more. Let's see what else the right hand is a symbol of. All right, let's see what else the right hand is a symbol of. Turn me in your Bibles for a moment. You remember Jesus? Before I go there, let me see. I told you, first of all, what is righteousness? What else is righteousness first? Then I'll come back to another symbol on the right hand. What else is righteousness? Turn me in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians 1:30. 1 Corinthians 1:30. And when you get there, just say amen. Are you there?
Amen.
In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30, the Bible says, but of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. Jesus is our what? Wisdom. Jesus is our what? Righteousness. Jesus is our sanctification. Jesus is our what? Redemption. So at the right hand of God, Jesus ministers what? What's he there for? What's the ultimate purpose he's there for? For your what? Sanctification and your what? Redemption. Are you with me now? So he's able to redeem those who will come to him in faith, believing that he is their great high priest and that he will forgive their sins and give them power to live a new life and obey God and keep his commandments.
Amen.
That's what it's going to do. But let's go a little bit closer and you'll see more. What else is righteousness? Turn me to Psalms 119, 123. I gave you this before. It's just a little quick review because some of you were not here earlier this week. But what else is righteous? Psalms 119, 123. It says, mine eyes will fail for thy salvation and for the word of thy righteousness. What is righteousness now? The word of God is righteousness. So Jesus, well, by the way, is Jesus the word?
Yes.
So remember, the word, the written word is righteousness, and also the word that was made flesh is righteousness. In John 1:1, what do we read? In the beginning was the what? Word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. And the word became what?
Flesh,
and dwelt among us in verse 14. Now, who was that word that was made flesh? Jesus. Is Jesus righteousness?
Yes.
And his written word is also what? Righteousness. In 2 Timothy 3:16, look what the Bible says there. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. Look what the Bible says. I'll wait for you. Can't wait too long. No, come on. I got a lot of cover. A lot of ground to cover with you. 2 Timothy 3:16. The Bible says. You're getting there now, okay? All scripture is given by what? Inspiration of God. And is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in what?
Righteousness.
So wait a minute. The scriptures give instruction in what?
Righteousness.
And how do you receive instruction from the scriptures? What do you call it when you receive instruction from the scriptures? What do you experience when you give instruction from the scriptures?
Transformation.
What do the scriptures give you? What do the scriptures inspire you with?
Faith.
All right, it inspires you with faith. So wait a minute, where does faith come from? Romans 10:17. Let's turn there for a moment. Romans 10:17. Right quick, I'm talking about righteousness right quick. Because Jesus is at the right hand of God, and he's ministering what? His righteousness. Because he's at the right hand, and the right hand is a symbol of his righteousness. Are you with me now? What does the Bible say there? So then faith coming by hearing, and hearing by the what? Hearing by the word of God. So we're going to find in that our faith in God is strengthened by the study of the word. How much faith you got?
Mercy.
Your faith is not based on the fact you came to church.
No. Amen.
Even though that's a symbol of your belief.
Amen.
Your faith is based on how much you are in the word of God and how much of the word of God is in you.
Yes. Hallelujah.
So I ask you again, how much faith do you have? Do you have big faith? Do you believe God can do anything? And do you have promises that back up your belief?
Amen.
Or do you just believe and kind of guess at and hope somewhere along the line God's going to do something?
Mercy.
When you shouldn't be guessing at anything, you should know from the scriptures what and where is your faith.
Amen.
And what and how to use the promises of God and stand on them even when things look like it's going contrary
Amen.
To what you're praying for.
That's right. Amen.
Because God can't lie. Amen. But you will be tested. Your faith will be tested. Your belief in the scripture will be tested. That's what you have to keep in mind. And when you are tested, you can't run. You can't be shaking in your boots. Oh, Lord, what's going to happen now? Right. You've got to be able to say, Lord, say, fear not.
Amen.
You've got to be able to say, God says to the mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast to the sea. I was at the airport one time, and a lady told me, said, Mr. Berry, I'm sorry, you missed your flight. I said, ma'am, I couldn't have missed the flight. I've got to be on that plane. I said, Mr. Berry, I'm sorry, they have closed the flight doors and you cannot get on the plane. And I said, excuse me for a moment. And I walked over in the corner. And I said, Lord, they said I can't get on the plane. Hey. I'm telling you exactly what I did. I said, Lord, they said I can't get on the plane. They said, okay, the door's locked. We got caught up in traffic. We got here a little late. They said, the doors are locked. What should I do? And I walked back up to the desk and I said, madam, can you check one more time? She said, Mr. Berry, I've already. I said, madam, can you check one more time? And when she went to check, I said, mountain,
yes.
Be thou removed.
Amen.
I did. I said, so that's what I said.
That's right.
And when I said that, the lady was checking, and she said, oh, you know, there's been a delay on the tarmac.
That's right.
And they hadn't really closed the door yet. So you got time to get to the plane.
Amen.
Amen.
I was on my way to Africa at the time. So I just want to let you know. But God is able if you believe the promise. Now what promise did I claim? Jesus said, verily, verily, I say to you, if you say unto this mountain, meaning a difficult situation, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore, when ye pray, believe that he receive it and he shall have it. But the receiving is based on your meeting the conditions of obedience so that you can have the blessing that he promised. That's what it's talking about. And that's what happened. Now, why am I saying this to you? Because I serve a living God.
Amen.
I'm not serving a God that's somewhere up in limbo. I'm serving the God that made the heavens and earth, the sea and the fountains of waters. I'm serving the Lord who made the seventh day Sabbath. I'm serving the Lord who has said, that you ask in my name anything, and I will do it.
Amen.
Especially if it's forgiveness of sin, it can come instant.
Amen.
You don't have, you know, but most of us wait for a feeling, you know.
Amen.
I don't feel like God forgave me. God didn't tell you to go about your feeling.
That's right. That's right.
God said, if you confess your sins, he was faithful and just in forgiving your sins.
Amen.
He said, well, Lord, I did some bad things. Well, just take them to God in prayer, confess them, and ask God to give you power to turn away from them bad things you did, and ask God to give you power to live a new life in Christ, and you have it.
Amen.
It's not some magical, mystical thing. Some of us waiting on the Lord to come down and say, I am God. Like a genie in a bottle. That's not going to happen. Your genie in a bottle is the Bible. Are you with me now?
Amen.
Believe what God's word says. That is your power.
Right.
You know, this is not a Latin slap. Oh, okay, Lord, I did good. Now, you going to bless me today?
Mercy.
No. Not going to happen. God's not blessing you because you just did good. God let the blessings come on the just and the unjust.
Amen.
God's rain falls for both of them. Even the evil people get blessed sometimes.
Well
and
said.
Even in that, God is trying to show them that he is a good God. Yes. And when they stand before him, they won't say that he didn't give them a chance to live.
Hallelujah.
Even they were evil. Are you with me now?
Yes.
He didn't cut them down because of their evil ways. He gave them space to repent, but they would not. Just like he didn't kill Cain when he killed Abel. He gave Cain space to repent, but Cain never repented. Cain never turned to God. But when he finally died, Cain's going to wake up 1,000 years too late. He's going to wake up in a second resurrection, and Cain is going to be destroyed.
That's right.
Have mercy.
Some people say, why won't God do something right now? Because he's not willing that any should perish.
Amen.
Murderers can turn around, you know.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. Drunkards can become sober.
Yes.
Prostitutes can become clean.
That's right.
If God can do that for them people, why do you think some of us are here?
That's right.
Some of us was murdered. Some of us were drunkards. Some of us were haters. Some of us were backbiters. Some of us were fornicators. Some of us were everything under the sun but a child of God.
Amen. Hallelujah.
And God transformed, changed our lives. And that's why we're here tonight.
Hallelujah.
The only reason why we're here.
Yes. That's right.
Because God somehow saw, but we would come that somehow, that in the right stand, right circumstance, in the right place, in the right time, many of us would hear the voice of Jesus, and we would get up and make a decision for Christ.
Yeah. Amen.
That's why we're here. That's why I'm here.
Absolutely.
Because I should have been dead on third. I should be buried on 13 Mile on DeQuinder in Detroit, Michigan. Mm-hmm. I was a couple of my friends who are already dead. Mm-hmm. God had mercy on my soul. Yes.
Praise the Lord. Yes, Lord.
And all the martial arts in the world can't dodge bullets.
That's right. Amen.
All the knife throwing and shirking throwing, all the kicks in the world can't stop a shotgun.
That's right.
Amen.
I'm just telling you why God is so good.
Amen.
But now let's see. Now we know Christ is at the right hand of God. He makes his intercession for us. Isn't that true?
Yes.
And the Bible said he'll be there, and we find that he's ministering his righteousness to us. Isn't that right?
Yes.
What was the last Bible text I gave?
Romans 10:17.
Romans 10. So your faith cometh by what?
Hearing.
And hearing by the word of God. That word hearing means to hear, to obey. If you're not willing to obey the word of God, then you really don't have faith.
Yeah. Amen.
Because faith without works is dead, but works is predicated on obedience.
Amen.
To the word of God. All right? So now, let's go back for a moment. Let's go to Revelation chapter 15, verse 8. Now, some things will be in the screen and some things will be in your Bible. Just keep your Bible open. Don't close it. Don't close your Bible thinking you're just going to be entertained. Amen. All right? Look at the Bible says.
Amen.
And the temple. Now, what's the word for temple we found out so far? Sanctuary was filled with smoke from the glory of God and from his power, and no man was able to what?
Enter.
Now, wait, before we do any further, the Bible said there's a sanctuary in heaven, right?
Yes.
Now, I want you to notice the first part. The first part said the temple was filled with what?
Smoke.
We're going to come back to that. But I want you to notice that before the temple was filled with smoke, look what the implication is. The implication is, as it says, it's filled with smoke from the glory of God and from his power. And it says, no man was able to what?
Enter.
Now, my question to you is, if I reverse that question for a moment, that means before the temple was filled with smoke, what does that mean? It means that men and women could enter what?
Amen.
The temple. We enter the temple by faith and by prayer.
Yes.
Amen.
Now, we're going to see, why can't no man enter the temple? Now I'm gonna give you the big picture first, because what? Intercession for the sinful human race has ceased. Right now, intercession is still going on right now. But the Bible says the Holy Spirit will show you things to what?
Come.
Pretty soon in this world, God will stop pleading for man.
Oh yes.
Meaning the last prayer is one day soon to be heard.
Yeah.
The last pleading of God for a sinful race is about to come. And the signs would be when you see Noah's day, Lot's day, and 2 Timothy 1:3-5, when men are lovers of their own selves, boasters, proud, truth-breakers, ungodly, unthankful, unholy, without natural affections, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Those are all the signs that show that the days are approaching when there'll be no more intercessors. We're coming very close to that time. Let's take a look for a moment. Intercession as high priest. What does it mean? It means that the investigative judgment that we talked about yesterday in the sanctuary is over. And that the saint, and it says here, and the sanctuary is cleansed, and those whose names remain in the book of life have forgiveness, pardon, by the blood of Jesus, and their sins are what?
Blotted out.
Now remember earlier this week we found out they're going to be blotted out in three places. What were they? Out of the what? Out of the book, out of his mind, and out of what?
Our mind.
Our mind. Let's go a little bit closer, though. Brought it out the book. Let's prove that for a moment. Yea. Now, if thou wilt forgive their sin, this is Moses speaking. God said, Moses, move aside. I'm going to destroy these people.
Yes.
And Moses stood in the gap and interceded for rebellious people.
Yes.
And he said, yet now, if thou wilt forgive their sins, and if not, blot me, I pray thee, out of thy what? Out of thy book which thou hast written. Exodus 32:33 says, and the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever hath sinned against me, him will I blot out my book. God will blot out our sins out the book of life, or he will blot our names out the book of life. Hopefully he will move our sins out, but not our name. Because our name is dealing with us having immortality as well, believe it or not. Let's go a little closer. We talked about Jeremiah 17:1. The sin of Judah was written with what? A pin of iron. Remember that? this going up briefly with for a moment. It's a bit of iron with the point of a diamond. It was graven on tables of the what?
Heart.
The tables of the heart refer to the mind. What is it on the tables of the heart or mind that must be removed? Answer, sin that left scars on our conscience.
Yes.
What does sin do?
Yes.
You ever had things you did that you wish you could just erase?
Oh, yes.
I've had some. I know all of us got a door in our mind that we don't even want to open.
Yeah,
true. We don't even want to forget it as far as possible. We can forget it. If we can just take it out, we would. But we just don't go there. And do you know there are times, there are certain things that happen in life that is so horrendous that sometimes you just have to seal it and don't talk about it.
So true.
But leave it with the Lord.
Amen.
I'm just telling you like it is.
Amen.
Because notice, what happens? Answer, sin has left what? Scars on the conscience. Let's go a little closer on this. It says, every impure thought, desire of ages, this book right here, page 320. If you haven't seen this book right here. Desire of ages. It says, page 320, it says, every impure thought defiles the soul, impairs the moral senses, and tends to obliterate the impression of the Holy Spirit. It dims the spiritual vision so that men cannot behold God. The Lord may and does forgive the repenting sinner. But, watch this, but though forgiven, the soul is marred. All impurity of speech or thought must be shunned by him who would have a clear discernment of spiritual truth. Let's go a bit closer. Now is your time to seek a preparation for the readiness for the fearful test that's before us. That holiness that without which no man shall see God. Let none say, my way is hid from the Lord. God taketh no knowledge of my ways. Now it may be that it is not too late. Now it may be that you can repent. But even if your pardon is written against your name, you will sustain terrible losses for what? Scars, notice this word, scars you have made upon your soul will remain. Talk about in this life. Meaning that you can give forgiveness, but you still reap the consequences of your actions.
Yes.
Are you understanding me now?
Yes.
God forgave it, but you might have a situation where some people will still remember what you did and don't like it.
So true.
That's the result. This is the scar. Are you with me now?
Yes.
It's like being pregnant. A woman gets pregnant out of wedlock. She goes have an abortion because she finds out the boyfriend doesn't want the baby. And then she's feeling bad, so then she has the abortion, and then now she's left with the scar. And the scar for her is the memory that she had a child and lost it. You understand what I'm talking about?
Yes.
All right? That's one way. Or if you were a thief, and you got caught, and you got put in prison, but when you come out, you want to get a good job, you try to get on your feet, but the record follows you.
Yeah.
Because that's the scar.
Yes.
Are you with me now?
Yes.
Don't you understand? Let's go a little bit closer. The Bible goes on and says, our high calling, page 227. Every mistake, every error, unimportant though it may be regarded, leaves a scar in this life and a blot on the heavenly records. But first of all, I want you to understand one thing. Thank God the scar is only in this life. It doesn't. It won't follow you in the life to come. Watch carefully now. We're going to find out. We're going to find out what's going to happen. This is why I want to give you this point. Every wrong action by frequent repetition leaves a permanent impression upon the mind of the actor and also on the minds of those who are connected with him in any relation, either spiritual or temporal. Let's go a little closer. All right? Testimonies, Volume 8, page 866. Those who take the lead in amusements, pleasure lovers, bring upon the cause a stain not easily effaced. Talking about pleasure lovers in the church. Listen carefully. It says, they wound their own souls and through their lifetime will carry the what?
Scars.
Keep talking about scars. We don't say about this in a moment. Listen carefully to this. Now I want to give the SDA Bible Commentary, Volume 3, page 1158. He may be converted. He may see the wickedness of his injustice to his fellow man. Talking about people, men have been come to Christ. And as far as possible, make restitution. But, what everybody? The scars of a wounded conscience will ever remain. That's what happens. right? Let me just see it. Conceal, it says here, Review and Herald, 3:24-18:7. No concealing sins from God. God sees the sinner. The eye which never slumbers knows everything that is done. It is written in his book. One may conceal his sin from his father, mother, wife, and friends. And yet all lies open before God and is placed in the book of record. David was a repentant man. Although he confessed and hated his sin, he could not forgive. Get the point. Bible says in Ezekiel 36:31, look what the Bible says. Then shall ye what? Remember your own evil ways and your doings that were not good, and shall loathe yourselves in your own sight for your iniquities and for your abominations. That's what Ezekiel said Israel will do when they come to themselves. When people come to themselves, they begin to hate the things they did.
Amen.
When people really want to do things right and get right with God, when they want to get rid of this empty feeling they have, you know, this emptiness that makes you almost want to feel like you want to commit suicide because you don't know what it is. You go to parties, you go to clubs, you drink, you party, you have sex, you get high, you do everything on the sun, and that emptiness just don't go away. That emptiness is to know not the love of a man, not the love of a drink, not the love of sex, not the love of marijuana, not the love of cocaine. It's to know the love of God. God has put that in the heart of every human being, that you can have everything in this life and not be satisfied.
Thank you, Jesus.
Until you learn to know the love of God. It is not looking for a man at the bar or a woman at a club or watching or paying some stripper. It is not none of that. It is the love of God that is burning, longing in your heart for something that you cannot have on this earth.
Amen.
Only heavenly, only God can give it to you. That is the love that keeps you from, that's the love that causes you to have, look at your parents in a different light one day.
Amen.
That's the love that changes the heart. And nothing you do will fill it. That's the love you need that's been leading you to go into depression. My husband don't love me no more. My children don't love me no more. Oh, I feel rejected. But first of all, before you worry about your husband and children's love, you need to think about one thing. How does God feel about you?
Amen.
And does he love you? And grab your and lay hold of his strength.
Yes.
Then he will transform your character, and your children, your family will recognize a change in you.
Amen.
You just see, come on. Bible goes on, sins blotted out the book now. But when the righteous turneth from his what? You know, some people say you're once saved, always saved. I want you to just listen to Ezekiel very carefully and tell me from the Ezekiel, are you once saved, always saved? I just want you to understand this right quick. It says, when the righteous turneth away from his righteousness and committeth iniquity and doeth according to all the abominations that the wicked man doeth. Now, I'm talking about a righteous man who turned from his righteousness, backslid, left Jesus, left the church, did everything on his side, and now goes to the same thing the wicked man does. Now, is he going to be saved because he believed in Jesus? No, wait a minute. Once saved, always saved, right? Wrong. Look what Ezekiel said. It goes on and says, doeth according to all the abominations that the wicked man doeth, shall he live?
No.
The answer is all his righteousness that he has done, everything that he done for God. Listen carefully. All the righteousness that he has done shall not be mentioned in his trespass that he has trespassed, and in his sin that he has sinned. In them he shall he what?
Die. Amen.
I know once saved, always saved, folk.
Mm.
Better go again. What the Bible says. Book Great Controversy, page 43. In the issue of the judgment, it says, names are accepted, names are rejected. When any have sins remaining upon the books of record, unrepented of, unforgiven, their names will be blotted out of the book of life. Is your name in the book? And if it is, are you confessing and putting away your sins so it can stay there?
Amen.
Or are you procrastinating and saying, I'll do it some other time? I know I need to confess, but I'm not going to do it right now. I'm having too much fun in sin. Having too much fun with fornication.
Mercy.
Listen, having too much fun lying and cheating on my job as a businessman.
Mercy.
Huh? Look what it says here. I'm repented of and I'm forgiven. Their names will be blotted out of the book of life and the record of their good deeds.
Yeah.
will be erased.
Amen.
Oh, have mercy. Will be erased from the book of God's remembrance. Did you know God write down every good thing you do? And if you're saved, it'll be there. But if you lost, you won't. It won't come up. You remember the Bible said in the book of Malachi?
Yeah.
Then they that feared the Lord spake it off from one to another, and a book was written called the Book of Remembrance.
Amen.
And every good thing that you've done is in that book. Every kind word you said, every act of kindness you've done is in the book. But you can fool around here and lose it. All who have truly repented of sin, by faith, claim the blood of Christ as their atoning sacrifice, have had pardon entered against their names in the books of heaven. And as they have become partakers of his right, of the righteousness of Christ, their characters are found in harmony with the law of God. With the what?
The law of God.
So you mean the law of God is binding in the last days?
Yes.
Oh, I thought you don't need no law. You're not a law, you're under grace, right? But what did Hebrews 8:10 say? We're under the new covenant. Ah, that's right. Under new covenant, we under love and grace. Under the new covenant? Let's see. Let me push a button. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 8, verse 10. And let's see what the new covenant says, all right? Let's see the new covenant, right? Just so you can get it. Come on. Because you got preachers saying, we're under new covenant, we're under love and grace and everything else. That's not what the Bible says. Look what the Bible says here in Hebrews 8, 10. And it said this. Now, this is the new covenant, folks. Why? This is the New Testament. Are you with me now? I'm not reading from the Old Testament.
Yes.
The Old Testament, the law was written on tables of stone, wasn't it? But now, on the new covenant, where did God say he was going to put his law? You say you want the new covenant? Is the new covenant doing away with the law of God? Is the new covenant doing away with the Ten Commandments? Or is the new covenant establishing the Ten Commandments? What's it doing? Look what the Bible says. And this is the covenant that I'll make with the house of Israel after those days, said the Lord. I'll put my laws in their minds and write them in their hearts. And I will be them a God, and they shall be me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord. For all shall know me, from the least to the greatest. And I'll be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more. When is he going to do this? Under what? New covenant. But where's the law in the new covenant? It's written on your what? Heart. In your mind.
Amen.
Not here. Here.
Amen.
Are you with me now?
Yes.
Look what it says. It says here, and their characters are found in harmony with the law of God, and their sins will be what, everybody? What did God say? I'll be merciful to unrighteousness, and their sins and iniquities will I remember what?
No more.
So the no more, to remember your sin no more means he's going to block your sins out.
Oh, yes.
But won't that be nice? You don't understand that. Some of you walk around with, you ever remember a sin you did 30 years ago and you never did it again? Mm-hmm. And it's like pop back in your brain, so why am I thinking about this? I'm not doing that anymore. Yeah, they'll even dream about it at times. Okay, you better watch that one.
Yeah.
That will be working on them, all right? Look carefully. But look very carefully. Their sins will be blotted out, and they themselves will be accounted what? Worthy of eternal life.
Oh,
my. Look here. Jesus held his wounded hands. Now, why? How is this going to happen? Listen carefully. Listen to this one. Jesus held his wounded hands above him. Somebody above the mercy seat. And said, my blood alone can affect it. If thou wilt henceforth choose the path of humble deeds and rely solely upon the merits of my blood to cover thy what? Thy past transgressions. This is called imputed righteousness. Jesus, when you give your life to Jesus, he imputes his righteousness to you. Your sins of the past are forgiven as you experience receiving the Spirit of God and being born again. And it starts right here. Efface. The word efface means to make indistinct or to erase. Your sins of the past will be forgiven and eventually it'll be what?
Erased.
If you don't go back to them. Alright, let's go back. Let's go closer. That's what the Bible says. I will blot out thy transgressions and cover thy sins. But if you choose the path of transgression, you must reap the transgressor's reward. The wage of sin is what?
Yes.
Romans 6:23 tells you that. Now, one more. The great day of the Lord is near. When Christ appears in the clouds of heaven, now this is what I want to tell you, because some people believe when Jesus comes, they're going to be saved. Because they're going to get on knees and pray. They say, Jesus, here I am, oh man, I'm not. Don't even think. Let me help you out. The great day of the Lord is near at hand. When Christ appears in the clouds of heaven, those who have not sought him with all the heart, I'm reading again, those who have not sought him with all the heart, Those who have allowed themselves to be deceived will surely perish.
Say it again.
I'm going to read it again. The great day of the Lord. This is talking about the second coming of Jesus, ladies and gentlemen. This is talking about when Jesus comes in those clouds of heaven. And you said, and you finally understand that this world is going to end. You're going to finally understand, because some of us keep ignoring the fact the wage of sin is death. If you didn't believe anything else down here, if you really didn't want to believe the Bible, then only ask yourself one question. Why can't nobody else but the Bible truly explain death?
Mm.
You don't believe it, just stop by the graveyard. Mm. Just take a good look.
Yeah.
Go by the funeral home. That's a, you know, we, the, you know, black folks especially, we're scared to go by the graveyard. Oh, not the graveyard, not at night, not at night. Oh, no, no, I'll buy it during the day. Not going by the, that's the most safest place in all the world.
Yep.
Because they know nothing, hear nothing, see nothing. They're not getting up and they're not coming back.
Yep.
They're laying there dead, sleeping until Jesus wakes them up. Are you with me now? So nothing else, nothing going on out there. If you see something walking around that kind of big and black and dark, you better know it's not one of them, it's a demon.
Amen.
You better know in the name of Jesus, depart from me.
Yes.
Never forget, I'll never forget, I'll never forget. One day I was in a house. And I went to this house, I'm knocking on doors. Man comes in the door, what do you want? I said, sir, how you doing? My name is Maurice Berry, and I'm from the Family of Education Service. My call is of special importance. If you have any problems we face in our world, you wouldn't mind if I speak with you briefly, would you? And the man said to me, well, hold on a minute. He started unlocking all the locks on his door. He's standing there looking at me, and he says, now, what do you want? As I walk him through the door, though, the Holy Spirit said, don't sit down. I looked behind me, the man had slammed the door and locked all the locks on the door. I said, Lord, you got to get me out of here. And then all of a sudden, while the man locking locks on the door, he turns around, and when he turns around, he says, now, what do you want? When I looked around, the man was standing in the living room stark naked, saying, now, what do you want? And I said to him, sir, now, this wasn't no time for a sales talk. But I was showing these books at the time, and I realized at this point it wasn't about showing this book. I said, sir, God loves you, but he hates your sin, and he wants you to repent.
Amen.
He said, you dare come in my house and tell me to repent? Who do you think you are? I'm a preacher too. I have a large congregation. Look at my wall, he said. I looked on this wall and there was a large congregation. And he said, now, you wait right here. And I was praying, I said, Lord, you got to get me out of here. And all of a sudden the man came back out, and I thought he was going to put some clothes on. Came back out with a black cape tied around his neck. And he said, now look me in the eye. And I'm looking him in the eye because I don't want to look nowhere else. I'm looking in the eye and he's looking at me. We're staring at one another, just like this. And he's standing there, and I'm standing here, and he's going up. Then he started raising his hands, up on the devil. And as he was sitting there doing that, I said, Lord, what should I do? That morning, I got up and I read this book, Desire of Ages. And as I was reading Desire of Ages, I read something in this book called There's Power in the Name of Jesus. See, I heard about it before, but I had never experienced it before. You know, a lot of things you hear about in the Bible, but until you get in certain situations, you never experience it. And I heard there was power in the name of Jesus. So I began to think to myself, I said, Lord, what should I do? And the Holy Spirit said, call on Jesus. Say Jesus. And I said, Lord, well, wait a minute. Then I thought about it. My mind went back. I said, okay. All right. So the man starts talking about speaking in another tongue and calling on the devil. And I said, Jesus, like that. He jumped back. I said, whoa, did he jump?
Yeah.
You know, and I thought again, and he went back, and he came back, up, and I said, jeez, again, he jumped back again. I said, whoa. Oh, man, courage came up in me then. Oh, man, you know, I said, wow. I said, Lord. Then next thing you know, he said it again. He said, up, like that. And I said, in the name of Jesus, like that. And when I said the name of Jesus, the man said, ah! He said, I can't see! My eyes, I can't see! I can't, my eyes! He fell right in front of me. He said, who are you? Who are you? Where are you from? Your concentration too strong. Who are you? I said, sir, let me tell you something. Nevertheless, I live, and not I, but Christ who lives within me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. God loves you. He hates your sin. He wants to repent. You have a good day. And I started walking towards the door. And I started unlocking all the locks on the door. Took my case and was going up the door. The man said, where are my eyes? Where are my eyes? I said, your sight will return to you when I leave.
Amen.
And I walked in that front porch and I said, thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
I got on that front, I was so happy. I said, thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Because we're told in a book called Corporate Ministry, every true child of God has a companionship of angels.
Yes.
Angels of light and power.
Yes.
And the meek and lowly ones who believe and claim the promise of God, they are ever near to heal, to instruct, to protect, and power of God.
Amen.
I'm talking about the power of God. It's one thing to preach this message to you. It's one thing to read all these statements to you. It's one thing to have to experience things. God wants you to have an experience in missionary labor.
Amen.
So you can have power.
Yes.
Christians are not weak people.
No.
We're not always mamby-pamby. We're always going, well, praise the Lord. Just praise the Lord. And just keep hit all the time. Sometimes you got to be great. Sometimes you got to be humble and meek. And other times, there, Christian, you have to be, as a warrior for God, you got to be bold and courageous. Sometimes you got to be forthright with people. Man looked at me and said, I don't believe in God. So what you got to say? I said, hold on. Hold on. I'll tell you what I'm going to say. I'll tell you right here. I said, read this book. He took the book. A fool has said in his heart, there is no God. He said, hey man, you call me a fool? I said, no, the Bible. Brother looked at me one day, I had a Muslim brother do the same thing. Come and hey, here you go, my brother. Yo, my brother. You see, you reading that white man's Bible. You know King James was a punk and a sissy.
Yeah.
That's what he told me. I said, really? He said, yeah. He said, now let me tell you something, my man. He said, no, my brother. What you need to do, you need to become of the honorable, follow the honorable Elijah Muhammad. You said, yeah, I said, hold on, let me stop you right now. Stop all your propaganda. Look at me, so what do you say? I said, I'm gonna stop your propaganda right now.
Yes.
I said, I ask you a question, how much money you got in your pocket? He said, what? I said, how much do you got? And he said, I got 20. I said, can I borrow? He said, thank you. And then I said, you got another 20? He said, yeah. I said, can I get it? Thank you. I said, have a good day. Take care. He said, hold on, my brother, you got my money in your pocket. I said, sure do. He said, my brother, give me my money back. I said, no, man, you don't need this money. He said, my brother, you're taking my money. I said, no, I'm not taking your money. I'm just taking that white man out your pocket. That brother sat there and he said, what? Oh, I said, yeah. I said, you know the value of this dollar, of this money. Just like I know the value of this book.
Amen.
And so therefore, because I know the value of it, that's why I'm out here with it.
Yep.
And I'm going to tell you one thing right now. Muhammad didn't die for me.
No.
Muhammad didn't rose. And your Muhammad is in the grave. My Jesus is alive and well.
Amen.
The high priest at the throne of the sanctuary in heaven.
Amen.
He said, my brother, you're a dangerous individual. I said, I'm going to be a dangerous individual, all right, because I'm going to tell you something right now. But Islam, and I said, Muhammad not going to win. Jesus is going to win this battle.
Amen.
I said, Aslam alaikum. So there. I'm telling you missionary experience in between.
Yes.
Why am I telling you? Because I'm talking about the power of God. Probation about the clothes. God wants to pour out his spirit on his people and give them power to meet the oppositions that they're facing out here in this
community.
And all Christians now they're scared. Oh, scared of. You can't be, listen. If you love Jesus, you have to get to the point where you lay down your life.
Amen.
Because you're going to preach this gospel come what may. You're going to tell it come what may. You're not going to be afraid. You're not going to be scared.
Yes,
I remember
right.
A gang met me on the corner of the streets of Detroit. Stood there in the gang and said, yo, man, what you got, man? What you in this corner? Man, you're on the wrong turf. Don't you understand that, brother? You're on the wrong turf. I said, excuse me. He said, man, you heard us. You're on the wrong turf now. And this is at the time they had Young Boys Incorporated, and they were shooting brothers right off the street. And I'm out there doing missionary work with a book. I got this book here, Great Controversy, and Bible reading for the home. And I went in my bag, and I was carrying with me and said, bro, what you doing in my neighborhood that's shirt in town and stuff like that? Who you think you are, man? You think you're some sir, some Philadelphia lawyer or something? I said, excuse me, sir. He said to me, but now that during that early that day, I went to a house, I was knocking on some doors, and I went to a house, and a lady came to the door and she said to me, Mister, I hurt my ankle, and the pain is just so bad. I just been hurt for 3 weeks. I just can't do nothing. I said, madam, you mind if we have a word of prayer? And I prayed with the lady at the door.
Yes, Lord.
And when I prayed, the lady said, thank you, and walked away. Now, I'm down the street now. Now I'm confronted with this big gang, 10 guys. Now I knew martial arts back then. I'm thinking to myself, oh Lord, this is gonna be a fight here. What am I going to do here? You know, I was trained 30 seconds per person. I was not trained to get a trophy. I was trained to break, kill, lame. Michigan. Brothers who know what I'm talking about. For police officers know too. You got 30 seconds just to do your opponent. You do longer than that, you will die. You're going to be killed. And anyway, I was thinking like, but because I gave my life to Jesus now, I said, Lord, I can't use my martial arts. I'm depending on you.
Yes.
And God pushed me like this. So what you gonna do, man? I said, oh, Lord. And you don't understand what that means in the street in Detroit. When the brother put his hand on you like that was it. But now I'm like, oh. So the guy said, so yo, what you got, man? So hurry up. Strokes was in the bag. And I had a partner with me. A partner was, man, Barry, I know my boss. You know, my boss. I said, no, we're not. He said, yeah, man, we're going to do something, man. I said, no, we're not. Just pray.
Amen.
So I told him to pray, and we prayed. We were praying in our minds. And the guy said, come on, man, Strokes in the box. Don't play with us now. We're not playing with you, Strokes, now. I said, all right. You want to know what I got in my bag? Fine. In my bag, and then I reached down, they all came close. I said, in my bag. And I put on my preacher's voice. I said, in my bag is a revelation of a living God. Receive my faith. It has power to transform your life. I'm so glad y'all stopped me today so I can talk to y'all about Jesus. And they said, whoa, hold on, man. Hold on, man. I'm not in for no Jesus. No, I'm out of here. And then a little girl came running down the street while I'm doing this. Said, leave that man alone. He prayed for our mama, and our mama got healed.
Amen.
But the gang leader said, what? Said, yeah, mama's leg, mama's ankle got healed. Mama told me to go find that man and bring him back to the house. Yeah. Find out who he is and what he got. I didn't heal that woman. God's power healed that woman.
Amen.
Angel of God drew near that woman. And he did it for his glory while the gang is sitting there thinking about beating me up and robbing me. All of a sudden, when the gang leader found out his mama got healed, the little sister would come right on the tree saying that. The gang leader said, are you sure? I said, yes. He said, hey, man, I don't know who you are. He said, man, what should we call you? Who are you? I said, I'm the Bible man. The Bible man? I said, yeah, I'm the Bible man. For y'all, I'm the Bible man. I go in your house, tell you the Bible, and I pray with you. And that man said, okay. He said, anytime you come in this area, Bible man, nobody will touch you.
Amen.
You come here at 12 o'clock at night, nobody will touch you. My boys will look out for you. You can go in here and sell your books and collect your money. Nobody will buy you. One day I was walking down the street. Me and my friend walking down the street one night as we're trying to sell our books. And the gang leader says, they would say, hey, how you doing? Everything, and keep on going. And there was a formed gang from another side that came over. And these guys got behind us and walked us up. Yeah, but we gonna mess y'all up, man. You know how they talk all out in the back of you? That intimidate you. Yeah, man, we talking to two guys in them suits up there. One of the guys across the street saw Hayes. He said, hey, man, you talking to them two guys right there? I said, yeah. He said, man, you don't mess with them. I said, what do you mean? He said, man, don't you know who those two guys are? He said, no, who are they? He said, man, one of them guys is the Bible man. He said, the Bible man? He said, yeah. He said, man, don't mess with that brother. He said, when that brother pray, strange things happen. You don't want to mess with that brother. Then the brother said, hey, yo, man, you the Bible man? I mean, I heard about you. Oh, hey. Amen. Amen. We're sorry, man. We didn't mean anything.
All right.
Now, who did that?
God
did that.
Amen.
The Bible said, I'll put the fear of you, the dread of you before your enemy.
Yes.
I'm just telling you what God does.
Yes.
See, sometimes I got to tell you the theory, and sometimes I got to tell you some practical stuff.
Yes.
I'm giving you the theory and everything, but I got to tell you some practical stuff. Because you got to understand that when you work for Jesus, you're going to have all type of things.
Yes.
But you got to know that God has power.
Yes.
Man, I'll never forget. A woman sat there one day. I got to tell you this one. I got to get fitted. I'm calm, man. So much to do. Let me hurry up. All right? Let me tell you this story, just so you can get it. I met this one situation where a woman, I had canvassed this woman on Great Controversy. She loved the book. Her name was Deborah. So Deborah, this volume here, The Great Controversy. This volume begins where the Bible ends and tells the story of the conflict between good and evil, between Christ and Satan. And what a conflict. The law and long-suffering of Christ, the destruction of Jerusalem. It will help you understand many, many things in this volume. And as I was talking about this, it will talk about past, present, and future events. It will tell you about the issue of the judgment and what's coming on. When Luther stood before Wittenberg and nailed his 95 theses to the door of Wittenberg, how that brought about the Protestant Reformation. And it will talk about Christian history and the rise of the papacy and her downfall at the end of time. This will help you understand that one day Jesus will come. It will cover much, much more than what I'm talking about now. Before I got finished, she said, I want that book. And so I said, you sure you want it? She said, yes, I want to get this book. And as I showed her the book, and I was showing her, She said, I'm going to buy it. And then she said, devil, let's have a word of prayer. So we got ready to pray. And when she got ready to pray, she said, oh, I see him. I see him. I said, Deborah, what do you see? She said, I see these dark beings. They're dark, black, giant wings. And they're trying to stop you from praying.
Yeah.
I said, Deborah, close your eyes. Give me a hand and let's pray. We got on our knees and we prayed. We got on our knees and we prayed. I said, Lord, in the name of Jesus, remove the evil spirits from this place.
Yes.
And let me tell you something. When she woke up, she went, oh, they're gone. They're gone.
Amen.
They're gone. So what church you go to? What church you go to? I've been to other pastors. I've been to other churches. But nothing like this ever happened. When I see them and they can finish praying, they're still there. They're gone. What church you go to? I said, I go to the Seventh-day Adventist church. They said, we go to church on Saturday. Sasha, I want to go to your church. And do you have a pastor that I can talk to about my situation? I said, I'll find out. I called a lot of pastors in the area. None of the pastors wanted to deal with it. They began to say, oh, she's mentally ill. Yes, you need to let go to a psychiatrist or go see a shrink. That's what a lot of them said. There was one pastor they didn't like. There's some of the people didn't like because he always told the truth. Not like today. Anyway, and this pastor was out in the boondocks. His name was Elder J.P. Lewis. Never forget. Elder J.P. Lewis. Not Stephen Lewis, but J.P. Lewis. Elder J.P. Lewis said, Brother Berry, because that was my first time. Said, Brother Berry, if she's still willing, bring her to me.
Amen.
But before you do, go in her house, collect all her jewelry. I said, her jewelry? I said, yes. When you go in the house, check out her music. I said, her music? He said, yeah. He said, when you go in the house, check out her gospel music and her jazz, soul, whatever it is. And ask her, can you collect it? And when you go in the house, look for any t-shirts or anything that has with it images of Satanism or skulls or bones or anything like that. I said, are you sure, Elder? Are you sure about this? He said, yeah. Just listen to me. Listen to me. He said, listen to me.
That's right.
The lady wants to be free.
Yeah.
Yes.
But she doesn't know what she's been indulging in.
Yes.
He said, just do what I ask you. And if she's not willing to do it, don't bring her to me. And I told her what he said. She said, okay. So then he said, look for any books on astrology and dreams. And she had books on astrology and dreams and interpretation. She had bracelets that her boyfriend had gave her and everything else. And then he told me, he said, find out what happened to her. And Deborah told me a story. So one day, me and my boyfriend went to a club. And there was a man at the club that said he could hypnotize people. And she said, honey, he said, baby, come on, let's go to this club. Your man can't hypnotize us. Come on, let's go on down. Come on, let's just have some fun. None of the friends wanted to go, but me and my boyfriend went down. Before we knew it, the man had hypnotized us, and we were doing everything. And our friends began to tell us when we were home all the things we'd done that we were not even conscious aware of that we had done. We couldn't have did that. We laughed and talked about it. So then later on that night, and later on the next day, she said, I started seeing things. I would go in the mirror and I'd see a black figure walk by me or run past me in the room and stuff like that. He said, then he became more bold and more brave. And at nighttime, I could feel a presence over me. Sometimes, he said, I could feel sometimes something pressing me down. And I didn't know what it was. And by the way, on that one, some of us have had experiences where we're laying in the bed and something's pressing us down. Because I had it before. And you're going to go, your friend, your wife, your husband, whatever, can be sitting right there on that side of it. And you go. And you're trying to say something, say something, and you try to get out, can't get out. Then you want something to say, Jesus, you want, Jesus, and it finally breaks.
Yes.
You know what that is? That's demonic attack. Because of something you have in your house that you give Satan a legal right to come at you with. Because it's his. For me, it was my music. It was my soul music. And all my records and stuff that I had. And some of the rings I got from strange places. Can you like it is?
Yes.
And I didn't even know how to deal with that. I was sometimes get paranoid. I would leave the light on at night. But when it started happening with the light on, that really tripped me out.
Yeah.
And I found out the only thing delivering me was Jesus.
Yeah. Amen.
And I'm telling you this because I want you to understand how real it gets. You are not wrestling with flesh and blood. The Bible says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. What happened in this case was, so when I told Deborah about this and she agreed to it, we took all her rings, jewelry, bags of jewelry, clothes, things with paraphernalia on it, skulls and bones, all kinds of stuff. A lot of this stuff was her boyfriend's doing. We found out as we would go through. Then he told me, he said, now, she came to church with us that Sabbath. And after that Sabbath, I got some elders to come together and pray with her. And we served with her in prayer. And the pastor told me, he said, now, if she starts acting strange when you pray, tell her to say Jesus. Mm-hmm. I said, okay. So she went, we got in a circle of prayer, and she said, oh, so my head hurt a little bit. I said, Deborah, say Jesus. Said Jesus. Said, oh, wow. She said, disappeared. Mm-hmm. She was doing that. I thought first, oh, man, this can't be happening, right? So we got in the car. I have to admit, I was in a little state of unbelief, okay? We got in the car, but I knew something was wrong, okay? We got in the car. It takes 30 minutes to drive from Detroit to Inkster, Michigan. 30 minutes flat. We got in the car. We were over an hour on the freeway with no traffic, because of something that happened in the car. We got in the car, me and two elders, and two other elders were in the back seat. Me, I was driving, and Deborah was on this side. And while we're in the car, Deborah starts saying, oh, you know, I'm so glad I went to this minister. And she says, but I'm just so tired. And then so we thought she was gonna go to sleep. Then she says, but you know, she says, my head is hurting. My head, I said, Deborah, say Jesus, Lord. Jesus, Lord, Jesus will always stop and stop. Then she goes, my head is hurting. I said, Deborah, say Jesus, Lord. I said, Jesus, Lord. And it stopped again. She said, And he said, my head. I said, Deborah, say Jesus. She said, Jesus, Lord. They said, no, Satan is Lord. Her voice changed right in front of me. Her body stiffened up like a board, and she said, and a deep voice came out of her, Satan is Lord. This is not a movie. And I'm in the car, and the two elders, when they hear it, I look in the back seat, look in the mirror to see what they're doing. They're down at the bottom of the seat going, Father, we're trying to have a holiday. And I'm praying the Lord's prayer. And I'm praying, I'm saying, Lord, don't let this woman touch the steering wheel, okay? And I'm on the freeway, and we're on the freeway. I'm thinking to myself, we should be there by now. And we're at 35 minutes, 45 minutes, over an hour went by. And we're on the road driving at 75 miles an hour, and yet we're not going nowhere. You don't believe this stuff. You know, that's something you see in the movies, right?
It's true.
No, this is real deal. I'm in the car, I know, because I never forget when her voice changed, I said, whoa, what's going on here? I was driving on that steering wheel as hard as I could. Lord, please, don't let her touch this wheel, you know. And I'm telling the brothers, pray, and in the back, they're down in the bottom seat. Lord, please help us, Jesus. Please, have mercy. Listen. You know, you can laugh. We can laugh now. When you're dealing with this stuff, you're not laughing. You understand whatever's in them can get in you?
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
You know if you're not right with God, whatever power, whatever strength that girl got, she can it can throw you around like a toy and tear you up and half kill you. You know good well what you're dealing with then. And I was praying, I said, Lord, please help us. And then suddenly, the girl fainted. When she fainted, I looked up and there was our exit. We got off, drove up in the church parking lot. And the brothers looked at me, should we wake up? I said, what do you mean, should we wake up? We gotta wake up. I said, now if y'all afraid, just step back. Now, because by the way, before we even did this, because we knew we were gonna have a decision, I told these two elders, we had fasted 3 days prior.
Yeah.
Not something we just entered into. I'm just telling you, never jump in. You came to midnight and said, something happened, I wouldn't even address it. Because I got to make sure I'm right.
Yes.
Then I got to make sure this God is telling me to do it.
Yes.
Amen. If God don't tell me to do it, I'm sorry. You might just, I tell you, I'm not the one.
Amen. Well said.
Yeah, right now. I don't play when it comes out of this stuff, all right?
That's true.
So we're sitting there, And all of a sudden, we had to wake. I said, Deborah? She said, huh? Oh, we're here. I said, yes, Deborah, let's go. And two others came with me. We walked into the pastor's study. We got in the pastor's study. When we got in the pastor's study, the lights went. Lights went off. And Ella Lewis looked around and said, they're here. I said, what? He said, they're here. But when she walked in, that's when the lights went. And he said, Deborah, he said, do you want to be free? She said, yes. He said, Deborah, I want you now to just kneel with me and pray. Do you want Jesus to be your, come in your life as your Lord and Savior? Do you believe Jesus can make you free? He said, yes. Now, Lewis didn't do a big, long, drawn-out story. He simply put his hand on her head. He said, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I ask in the name of Jesus, Lord, to deliver this young lady
from
this demonic possession.
Yes.
And free her from the bonds of Satan in
his house.
When he said that prayer, after we got off our knees, the room was bright. Deborah was crying in her right, but she's in her right mind. That day, I never forgot. Because I knew then that there's power in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
As I saw that situation, I realized then that I wanted to make sure everyone, day by day, that I wanted a living connection with God.
Amen.
That it wasn't just about preaching the gospel.
That's right.
It was really about living in life. It wasn't about just jumping up in the choir or singing a song and getting all happy with a praise team. It's about you living the life. The power of God may rest upon you through the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
I never forget that.
Yes.
And I had other experiences after that. And I'm going to close you with this one tonight. And on Friday night, we'll finish this on the blind out of sin. And when we get into Sabbath, we'll be dealing with the rise of Islam. And we'll see what happens, what the issue is on that. You don't want to miss that study. We may, because tonight, I realize the Lord wanted the people to know importance of the power of God.
Amen.
And I'm telling you these stories because they're a true story.
Amen.
And if I didn't have them personally, I wouldn't be able to tell you.
That's right.
One day, it's important that you commune with God, but you never know where God will tell you to go.
Amen.
One morning, I got up early and decided, Lord, wherever you want me to go today, I'll go. And just then, this particular morning, I went out in the field knocking on doors. And in the midst of it, before mid-afternoon, I was impressed that I needed to go to the hospital. Well, they said, what do you mean go to, my friends looked at me and said, what do you mean go to the hospital? I said, Paige, we got to go to the hospital. All right. He said, okay. He said, now, okay, Barry, we got to go to the hospital. I said, God is telling me we got to go to the hospital. And he kind of humored me and he looked at me and said, yeah, right. You mean God just wants you to go to the hospital. Okay. What hospital? I said, I don't know. I said, hold on a minute. And I went under a tree and prayed. I said, Lord, what hospital do you want me to go to? And the Holy Spirit said, Harper. So I went back to my friend and I said, Paige, I got to go to Harper Hospital. I said, so he said, we got in the car. He said, okay, let's go to Harper. Then while we drive, he said, well, who are you going to see? I said, I don't know yet. He said, what? He stopped the car. He said, we're going to the hospital. You don't know who you're going to see? I said, no, hold on a minute. I prayed. Holy Spirit said, go to Harper Hospital, you want to see a young lady. So I said, Paige, we're going to Harper Hospital, we're going to see a young lady. He looked at me. He said, yeah, right, okay. So he drove reluctantly to the hospital. We got out of the hospital, get up to the information desk, and I walk up to the information desk, and this is what I said. I said, pardon me, ma'am. My name is Maurice Berry, I'm a minister. And I'm here to see a young lady. And the lady looked at me and said, Mr. Berry, there's plenty of young ladies here. Which one are you going to see? I said, I don't know. Hold on a minute. I walked over in the corner. I prayed. I said, Lord, who am I going to see? The Bible said, the Holy Spirit looked and said to me, the young lady's on the third floor. And I said, and I went back to the lady. I said, it's a young lady on the third floor. She said, well, there are plenty of young ladies on the third floor. What's her name? I said, oh, I don't know. Hold on a minute. So I walked back over in the corner. I'm telling you exactly. I'm talking about communion with God. You know what I'm saying?
Amen.
This is all by faith.
Yes.
And by the way, I couldn't tell you the story if God didn't work miraculously in the story. But I'm telling you by faith what happened. So when I went to the corner again, the Holy Spirit said, her name is Johnson. So I went back to the desk and I said, excuse me, ma'am, I'm here to see a young lady on the third floor. Her name is Johnson. And she looked at her list and she said, Mr. Berry, we have plenty of Johnsons on the third floor. Do you know her first name?
Wow.
I said, no, I don't. And while we were doing this, a lady came through the hospital corridor, running through the hospital corridor, went up and signed on the desk. Quickly, it ran through the elevator. Me and my friend looked at each other and said, man, that lady's in a hurry. Man, well, I said, how are we going to get on the third floor? Because it says we don't have her first name. And the lady at the service desk was so nice to us. She said, take the back service elevator, Mr. Berry. And when you get on the third floor, just take that back service elevator. And hopefully you can get some help up there. Because I can't technically let you through because of that. But since you are a minister, I'm going to let you go up that back service elevator. So we went on the back service elevator, and we come up to the third floor. My partner looks at me and says, all right, so what are we going to do now? I said, we're going to wait. He said, what? I said, yeah, we got to wait right here. So we got off the elevator, we waited, and my partner would nudge me and say, is that them? He said, no. And then I saw a family walk by. He said, is that them? I said, no. Then he asked me again. He said, now, he said, who are we waiting on? I said, the Lord said the person's going to come. So he looked at me. He said, yeah, right. While he said that, a lady came walking around the corner. She had her head down. And she was full of tears. And I said, excuse me, ma'am. I said, my name is Evangelist Maurice Berry. And I'm here to visit you. She said, what? You here to visit me? I said, yes. I said, God has sent me to you. And she looked at me and she said, come with me. And she went around the corner on the third floor. We walked in the room, and there on the hospital bed was a little girl, 9 years old, and she was dying of sickle cell anemia. And she said, and I said, when we walked in the room, I said, this is my niece. And every day, she said, I've been praying. And so I saw the niece, and I pulled out the children's Bible story. And I read to her, volume 9 of the Bible story dealing with Jesus' second coming. That little girl looked at me with her little weak eyes and said, I want to be ready when Jesus comes. Will he heal me when he comes? I said, yes, he will. She said, can I keep this book? She took the book, she laid it on her chest, she just hugged it as tight as she could. She said, I want to be ready when Jesus comes. Oh, I'm so tired. And I said, you mind if we have a word of prayer? And I prayed that God would save their child. If he would not heal her now, that she'll be saved in the kingdom.
Amen.
And when I got through praying, the auntie, with tears in her eyes, said, you know, for 30 days, I've been praying that God will send a minister to the hospital. She said, for 30 days, I came every single day, and no minister ever came. I was constantly disappointed every day I came, and nobody came. She said, but I kept getting this assurance that someone will come. And she said, so today, I came to the hospital this morning. And she said, I came, but no one came here, and I left, and I was on my way home. And while I was on my way home, she said, a voice spoke to me in my car and said, turn around your car. There's a minister at the hospital that's going to pray for your deeds. So she said, I turned around my car as fast as I could on the freeway. I parked up in the parking lot. I jumped out the car. I ran through the hospital corridors. I went to the elevator. I went on the third floor. I went in the room where my niece was at. And I looked. There was no minister. And she said, it was just my imagination. And while I was walking around the corner, you came to stop me, and you told me that God has sent you. Said, now I know that God answers prayer.
Amen.
She said, let me tell you something. She said, I said, madam, I said, what room is this? She said, this is room 303. I said, what is your niece's name? She said, my niece's name is Kelly Johnson.
Amen.
She said, now I know God answers prayer.
Amen.
She said, I used to be a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. She said, but I backslid from God. But now, I'm going to come back.
Yeah.
Why am I telling you this? Because there's power in the everlasting gospel. There's power in the name of Jesus. Power for deliverance. Power for transformation of character. Power to be born again. Power to live right, to be right, and to do right, come what may, and stand for right, though the heavens fall. That power God has made available for you and me today. One day, knocking on a door, I had a little book called Bible Reading. And I was knocking on the door, the woman looked at me and said, Mister, do you know it's cold out here? It is below zero. What do you have that's so important? And you're going to knock on my door below zero weather. I said, ma'am, I said, my call is of a special importance. I said, behold, and I showed Daniel 2. And I said, behold, the image of a man. God has foretold that in the time and the image of man are the feet of iron and clay, a head of gold, a breast and arms of silver, a belly and thighs of brass, legs of iron, feet part iron and part clay, and a stone that will come and smite them into feet of iron and clay. I said, God has revealed these things to us. She stopped. She said, stop. So I dreamed about the foot in that image, and I've been wanting to know the meaning of my dream. And she said, no one can tell me the meaning of my dream. Can you tell me the meaning of my dream? I said, madam, the Bible says to law and to testimony. If you speak not according to this word, there's no light in it. She said, come on in my house. And she let me in the house. She said, and I said, what is your dream? She said, I dreamed this. She said, I dreamed I saw a foot of iron and clay. She said, I heard a voice that soon I will come and grind you to powder. And then she said, and I woke up in a cold sweat. And I went to my pastor. I went to the Jehovah's Witnesses and asked them. They couldn't do it. They couldn't tell me. She said, I went to the Baptist and they couldn't tell me. I went to the Church of God in Christ. They couldn't tell me. So I went to every church around and no one could tell me the meaning of my dream. So can you tell me the meaning of my dream? I said, only if it's according to the word of God.
Yes.
I said, but according to the symbols you had in your dream, each of the symbols match up with scripture. You saw the feet of iron and clay and a great image of Daniel 2. You heard the voice of a holy watcher declare unto you, soon I will come and grind you to powder. What does this mean? And what does it mean? The feet of iron and clay represents the union of church and state in the last days. Churchcraft and statecraft will come together. It's complicated. Daniel said he saw a stone that will smite them to feet of iron and clay. That stone represents the second coming of Christ. When Jesus comes, if you're not ready, the Bible says, whosoever fall upon the rock shall be broken. But whosoever the rock shall fall upon, it will grind him to powder. This is talking about you being ready for the second coming of Jesus Christ. If you're not ready, you'll be ground to powder, because the Bible said, then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall destroy of the brightness of his coming. When I said that, the woman said, stop! She said, that's the meaning of the dream! She said, that's it! She said, wait a minute, how much is that book? How much is it? She went in the butt, back room, and bought the book. And she said, for 3.5 years, no one can tell me the meaning of my dream. But today,
amen,
God has answered my prayer.
Amen.
Why did I tell you in Revelation 15:8? How do we enter the sanctuary?
Yes.
Through prayer.
Prayer.
Amen. Through faith and prayer.
Amen.
Prayer does not bring God down to us.
Amen.
But it brings us to God into his very presence.
Amen.
Why am I sharing this with you? Because you need not only to know theory and prophecies, you need to have character and experience with Jesus. A living experience. Something you can look back on and see where God's hand has been in your life. That is what helps you maintain and be sustained to maintain to be a Christian. You can't be maintained just by coming to church in heaven.
That's right.
And dancing. Street and jumping up and down and shouting. Your experience is only that you don't have no experience. You need experience where you can look back and you can tell some testimonies about the power of God and what he can do for you. You need to be working for others. While you work for others, God will show you his power, his grace, and his ability to answer your prayers instantly, and sometimes when you're not even thinking he's going to answer the prayer, he's answering.
Amen. Amen.
God has a thousand ways to bless you, but you know none.
That's right.
Those who accept the one principle of making the service of God supreme will find perpetually vanish and a plain path for defeat.